back at the University of South Dakota. How's everybody doing? I'm Jay Elsen, and tonight we kick off another season of Coyote Corner with a preview of USD's 2015 campaign. One step forward, two steps back. That pretty much sums up the past two seasons for the Coyotes. After notching four wins, including their first three ever in the Valley in 2013, USD stumbled to a disappointing 2-10 mark last year. Now, the season did show some promise early on as the Yotes split their first four games, recording home wins over William Penn and nationally ranked Northern Arizona, while losing on the road against eventual FBS national runner-up Oregon and dropping an eight-point decision at Montana, which ended its season in the second round of the FCS playoffs. Unfortunately, whatever footing the Coyotes had gained over that first month was lost in conference play. South Dakota went winless in the Valley for the second time in three seasons, losing all eight games by at least two scores. Now, Joe Glenn's team certainly hasn't forgotten about those results, and neither have people around the league. That was reflected in the Valley's preseason poll as the Coyotes were picked to finish 10th. No surprises at the top, with four-time defending national champion North Dakota State receiving 32 of the possible 40 first-place votes. The rest went to Illinois State, which finished as runners-up to the Bison in 2014. Northern Iowa was picked third, followed by Youngstown State and South Dakota State. In an interesting twist, the Coyotes actually fared much better nationally. They garnered 12 votes in the FCS preseason coaches poll. A total of six teams from the Valley were picked in the top 25, with NDSU and Illinois State once again leading the way. Now, what does all that mean? Well, nothing really, and it really means nothing to the Coyotes. They don't seem to care what anyone outside the program has to say, good or bad. They believe things are getting better, and they expect results.
It's a good thing we get to play all the games. You know, we'll be healthier. We got some birthdays that I've been praying for. Our team seems very determined, very confident, very motivated.
We're just coming in, trying to compete every Saturday. That's all we can do. Try to become a respected team in the Missouri Valley. We're not going to put a tag on how many wins we have to have this year or anything like that. We're just going to keep it basic and try to compete week in, week out.
The team's really bought in, and the character of the team's changed. And we're really looking to be competitive in the Missouri Valley this year. And nobody wants to go home this year in Thanksgiving. That's our goal.
2015 will mark the third straight year that the Coyotes will open the season with a new starting quarterback. Find out how Ryan Sager is handling his new full-time role when we come back.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
Injuries to several key players combined with an overall lack of production added up to some major frustration on the offensive side of the football for South Dakota in 2014. But with seven starters coming back and a number of potential playmakers emerging, the Coyotes figure to pack a much more potent punch this season. In fact, this could be the deepest collection of talent top to bottom that Wes Bichotter has ever had the chance to work with.
Ready, start.
As is the case with most teams, the offense will go as the quarterback goes. And for the third time in as many seasons, USD has a new number one. Ryan Sager proved capable last season, leading the Yotes to a 2-2 record in four starts. That experience, coupled with his rep-heavy offseason, is already paying dividends.
I think it all helps. The four games last year, playing a few big games, obviously getting a little bit of time at Oregon. Starting against Montana and Northern Arizona, it all factors into it. And then obviously having a full camp, a full spring ball camp to help tone my game and help get in sync with these receivers, it all helps.
Coaches and teammates agree Sager is throwing better and thinking quicker than he did a year ago. But most say his single biggest improvement has come in the leadership department. He's acting like this is his team.
You've just seen kind of the young man grow and do something that I always thought he was, just you see it. That was the guy that we recruited.
I started last spring ball when he started taking, you know, about all the reps when Kevin started having the back problems, and you know, we're saying you're gonna be the guy. So he really just stepped up his confidence, and he's been a real leader on this team.
He's out there loud and vocal. He's telling people, get there, get here, do this, do that. And that's what we need in our quarterback.
Sager will have no shortage of quality targets, At the top of that list is the team's reigning MVP, Eric Shuford, who led the Coyotes with 53 catches for 699 yards and 5 touchdowns in 2014. Last year's second leading receiver, junior Riley Donovan, is also back, as are senior Nick Meyer, junior Ben Kramer, and sophomore Brant Van Ruckel, all of whom recorded at least 2 catches last season. A handful of young guys will also be in the mix. Redshirt freshman Paul Anderson has been drawing praise from coaches and teammates since the spring, while true freshmen Shamar Jackson and Danny Rambo have impressed in fall camp.
They are definitely that talented, and it's good to see just them getting the playbook now. Like, they're picking it up pretty fast, so it's good to see them doing that and making some plays out there, and that's all you got to do in fall camp is just make plays.
Sager will also have a pretty valuable weapon at tight end. Aaron Ramsey exploded onto the scene in 2014, averaging almost 19 yards per catch in the Oats' first 6 games before a knee injury sidelined him for the rest of the season.
Speed's up, weight's up, so I'm fresh, really. After missing a lot of spring ball, stayed out of contact, out of spring ball, take it easy, and my body feels good. I mean, it's fall camp, so I'm a little sore, but other than that, it feels really good, and I think the season going forward should be pretty good.
As dangerous as South Dakota could be through the air, the ground game remains the team's bread and butter. The Coyotes ranked 7th in the Valley in rushing last season, but likely would have finished higher had they been able to stay healthy. With that in mind, adding depth at the running back spot became one of the primary focuses of the offseason. It was addressed through both recruiting and position changes, and the hope is that the team now has enough quality options to keep the running game on track for a full season.
Really, it's about, you know, making sure that we're using the right guys consistently day in and day out. You know what I mean? So that's probably the biggest thing that we need to do. And we did recruit some guys there. So it'll be fun to see where those guys are at and look forward to seeing how they can help this football team, because we have 5 to 6 guys that could potentially play at that spot.
Junior Trevor Bama, who's rushed for nearly 1,300 yards despite missing double-digit games over his first 2 seasons, will be the Oats' top option. Sophomore Corey Kilgore and true freshman Michael Frederick, along with junior fullback Drew Potter, also figure to see some carries. Exactly who will be paving the way for that running game and protecting Sager remains somewhat undecided. A couple of redshirt freshmen, Vermilion native Nick Jensen and Tanner Anderson, are competing to replace longtime left tackle Matt Huffer, while several guys are bidding to fill Andrew Schofield's shoes at right guard. 2 of the team's presumed starters, center Sam McLaren and right tackle Derek Chancellor, are coming off season-ending injuries, and both have been limited in fall camp. Graduate transfer Thomas McGuire, who started 24 games at Elon University in North Carolina the past 2 seasons, can play several spots. He'll see time as either a starter or top reserve, while incumbent left guard Niall Banks looks to be the only sure bet on the O-line. The Coyote defense has adopted a new look for 2015. Alex Heinert will look at how things are shaping up on that side of the ball right after this.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
Welcome back. Just 1 year after boasting one of the best defensive units in the Missouri Valley, the Coyotes took a step back in 2014, allowing 36 points and over 460 yards of offense per game. This offseason, adjustments in scheme and personnel have been made, and optimism is back in Vermilion in full force. For the details on the new-look USD defense, here's Alex Heinert.
2014 did not go as planned for a University of South Dakota defensive unit that had finished the year before as one of the best in the conference. Points per game and yards allowed were up, sacks and turnovers were down, but the Coyotes don't expect those trends to continue in 2015. The main reasons for that optimism include a new formation, several key position changes, and new blood in the coaching ranks. The most noticeable shift is schematically. Fourth-year defensive coordinator Jason Petrino has moved the Yotes from their familiar 3-4 base to a 4-3. The extra linemen should mean better run support, more pressure on the quarterback, and a more manageable learning curve.
When we've lined up and we've been able to play fast, when we've been at our best, regardless what defense we were in, So it's really kind of allowed those guys that maybe don't have as much experience can come in and just kind of get lined up, trust the progression, their key reads, and then just play fast.
The shift up front has resulted in a move inside for senior Drew Iddings. The Rapid City native has been a key contributor on the edge, starting 25 games the defensive end over the past three seasons, but the change has him excited for this season's prospects.
It moves me around a lot more, puts me in different positions, and it does keep me away from the doubles a little more, and it does free me up a little bit.
The big thing is that Drew's been able to go vertical a lot more than maybe lateral, and that's probably been the biggest difference for him, and that's a big body to move.
Iddings will be joined by fellow fifth-year seniors Nick Jacobs and Sean Breedle on the interior. On the edges, converted linebackers and former high school quarterbacks Andrew Van Ginkel and Colin Mertlich are projected to start the season at the defensive end spots. Mertlich, a true junior, and Van Ginkel, a redshirt freshman, have the build and the speed to become real assets to the Coyotes' attack. Experience at linebacker will be plentiful behind the new four-man front, with three returning starters all figuring to slot back in. Two-year team captain Kian Loggy will play a more central role in the new 4-3 scheme, a move the senior thinks suits him well.
We moved a lot of people into spots where you felt like they could succeed the most. I feel like that's a spot where it fits my talents and my abilities the best too.
Kian, you know, it's said he's really played three positions since he's been here. You know, he's played outside backer to the field, he's played outside backer to the boundary, and now he's kind of an inside linebacker. So a lot of things have changed for him, but he's accepted it really, really well.
Junior John Wessel is back at middle linebacker after an outstanding sophomore campaign that saw him finish second on the team in tackles, while senior Ryan Hillier returns as well after starting all 12 games at outside backer in 2014. The defensive secondary returns almost everyone from last year's unit, with the team's leading tackler Tyson Graham and Jacob Warner back at safety, and Chris Tyler and Mike Lilly manning the cornerback spots.
The majority of them that are coming back have played meaningful snaps in college football. You know, it's those guys having the confidence and understanding of what their responsibilities are.
On special teams, standout junior Miles Bergner returns as the team's kicker and punter for the third year after being named as an honorable mention All-Valley performer in 2014. The lone change is in the coaching ranks, as defensive line coach Marquise Williams is now in charge of the specialists this year.
Coach Williams came in with a different philosophy. He went with coverage first, kicking later. We've been diligently going through our coverage and how we get down there and how to tackle and how to get off blocks and things like that. So it's being approached in a much more fundamental way than it was before. It wasn't just throw the entire scheme at us and then we have to go do it. It's more of building up to that scheme.
Jason Petrino's new-look defense has been coming along through spring ball and fall practice, but they'll face a stiff test to start the season. The Yotes open against the Kansas State team that averaged 36 points and 420 yards of offense per game last year, including a whopping 42 a contest in Manhattan, Jay.
All right, thanks, Alex. We'll have more on that game coming up in a bit, but first, we want to talk a little bit more about that defense and some of the other preseason storylines for USD. We'll do that with MidcoSN analyst Andre Fields next.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
All right, we've looked over the lineup, and now it's time to tackle some of South Dakota's most prevalent preseason storylines. And here to help us out with that is a guy that will once again be joining us weekly here on Kyle Corner throughout the 2015 football season. And he is former USD defensive back and current MidcoSN analyst Andre Fields. And Andre, let's start with the quarterback. Coyotes haven't had a whole lot of continuity at this position, as you know. Ryan Sager, going to be the third opening day starter in as many seasons. Everyone wants to know what they can expect out of him, but my question to you is, what is fair to expect out of him?
Well, what I think is fair to expect, Jay, is a game manager. I think quarterbacks don't ever really want to hear that word, but I think Ryan came in last year, had four starts, was pretty average, 54%. I think three touchdowns, three interceptions were the numbers, so he's pretty average. And I think that's what you can be fair to expect out of him, is just somebody to come in, kind of manage the game, get a first down with his legs when he needs to, get a pass first down when he needs to, but nothing extravagant, nothing big time trying to force plays down the field or anything like that. Just more of a manager is what we should expect out of him.
And the good news is it sounds like, as far as those numbers, they expect them to go up because they think he's a better quarterback overall. But what USD really needs out of him is to be a leader, and it sounds like he's really come a long way in that regard. Certainly the quarterback is a guy you want to be that leader.
Yeah, you figure, like, four starts we said last year. He's had all spring ball as the number one. He's had the summer as the number one, and he came into fall practice knowing that it was his spot to lose. So, yeah, I think leadership is something that they truly, truly expect out of him, and I expect him to take a step up from that average spot to above average this fall.
All right, now anyone who has followed USD football last season knows that the injuries really piled up, especially at running back. Kyle simply ran out of guys by the end of the season at that position. That cannot happen again. And the coaching staff seemed to do everything it could to make sure it wouldn't. Aside from just having a little more luck, though, Andre, is there anything else that they can do to keep these guys on the field?
Well, they said that they have four or five different backs now, Jay, and they have young guys coming up that they want to try to get on the field in different positions. So I think what they can do is spread the ball around. If you have four running backs that you feel confident with, then spread the carries. By doing that, you take more strain off of each individual back. Everybody has an equal opportunity to carry the ball, and you spread the beating around a little bit. So I think that's the first thing that they're going to have to do.
And some of it falls on the individual players themselves being smart about the contact they accept.
Yeah, absolutely. If you have a chance to run out of bounds instead of take a hit, do that. Because as you know, especially here at USD, we've run out of backs. We don't need you to be tough. We need you to be available late in the season.
That is true. All right, let's move it over to the defensive side now. Andre, I know you're going to like this. After working out of the 3-4 the past few seasons, USD making the switch to the 4-3 base. And now Jason Petrino has liked what he's seen so far in this regard. And I think when you look at where the Coyotes struggled last year, it seems at least on the surface to be the right move. Yotes had a really tough time stopping the run. They also had trouble getting to the quarterback. So this should help in both of those areas.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you're putting more guys up front to get pressure on the quarterback, which is going to create then a rushed situation for the quarterback, which helps out the secondary. You have more bodies up front. That way, hopefully, you can out-leverage the offense and create that pressure. Hopefully, we'll see. The key for me is, do they have the personnel to fit into that 4-3 scheme? Because these guys came into USD as 3-4 guys. Now they're switching to a 4-3. Will they have the bodies and the capability to adjust to the new positions that they're placed
in? It's all part of what they're trying to figure out here this fall. Well, there's one more big transition taking place for the Yotes, and that's on special teams. USD really needed a boost in this area, and they're getting it from Marquise Williams, who's now dividing his time between the D-line and special teams. He's putting a big emphasis on the fundamental side of things. He wants to make sure that everyone knows their job, but more importantly, how to do their job correctly. Any thoughts on that strategy?
Well, special teams is the only play in football that averages at least 30 yards of field position. So it's huge. So anything you can do to put more emphasis on that segment of the game, it's going to pay off big time.
All right. Well, thanks to you, Andre, and we look forward to having you back each and every week here on the show. Well, the Coyotes are set to kick off the 2015 season this Saturday against Kansas State. We're going to preview the matchup with the Wildcats next.
Coyote Corner on Midco Sports Network is presented by Dakota Land Honda.
USD's 2014 season opener was without question the most difficult test that the program has faced to date, playing at Autzen Stadium against an Oregon team that was led by eventual Heisman Trophy winning quarterback Marcus Mariota. With that experience still fresh in their minds, the Coyotes are approaching Saturday's game at Kansas State with a kind of been there, seen that mentality, which should help them stay focused on more important things.
I think we'll go down there with, you know, some butterflies like you would have if you're playing anybody. And the bottom line is, you want to become a better football team, win, lose, or draw. And if you go play a really good football team, you'll have to go against really good competition. And I think good competition makes you better.
We go out, we fight, and we show that we can stick people, we can make the big plays, we can make catches, we can make the blocks. We can only get better from that. And it'll be a great experience being up against a team like K-State.
Despite returning 16 starters from a team that finished 9-4 overall and 7-2 with a Big 12 last season, the Coyotes are catching K-State in a bit of a rebuilding mode. Wildcats have a couple of sizable holes on offense after losing their starting quarterback and a pair of 1,000-yard receivers. All three were a huge part of what was the most prolific passing attack in school history. So while they get things figured out on that side of the ball, Bill Snyder's team will be relying on a very experienced defense to help carry them through.
They're really hard to trick. They're hard to fake out because everybody does their assignment. They all cancel the right gaps. The second level cancel and hit in their physical, very, very physical team. And the secondary usually sneaks a guy in there when you have a run emphasis, and they'll put eight guys into the box after the snap. They absolutely know what they're doing. They don't give up big plays. They keep everything in front of them, and really, really a well-coached team, and all Bill Snyder's teams have been. We will get their best Sunday punch, there's no doubt. They want to get off to a great start. They're at home, and they've been through this once before 2 years ago, so we won't catch them napping.
It'll be the first meeting between South Dakota and Kansas State since 1982, and it takes place this Saturday night, September 5th, at Bill Snyder Family Stadium in Manhattan. Now, I will be there, so be sure to check out MidcoSN.com for coverage through the Coyote Corner video blog. You can also follow me on Twitter, at ElsenMidcoSN, and be sure to check back here next Tuesday night for a complete recap of the Coyotes' 2015 season opener. Now, we will also be providing live coverage of USD football once again this season. Midco Sports Network is set to broadcast four of the five Coyote home games, including the September 19th home opener against Drake and the Showdown Series matchup against South Dakota State on November 14th. All right, that is our time for this week. For Alex Heinert, I'm Jay Elsen. We'll see you back here next Tuesday night for another episode of Coyote Corner.